Good afternoon, everybody. This is Viridiana Garcia Choi, Manager of Youth and Family Programs at the Hudson River Museum. The program today is the outdoor talk with Gretchen Sorin. Welcome, Gretchen.
Thank you.
I'm going to introduce her. Gretchen Sorin holds a BA degree from Rutgers University in American Studies and a master's degree in Museum Studies from the Cooperstown Graduate Program, a school from which she is currently the director. She has a PhD from Albany University in History. Dr. Sorin has more than 30 years of experience as a museum consultant. She worked from more than 250 museums. She has served as an exhibition guest curator for many exhibitions. Her books include Touring Historic Harlem, For Wax in Northern Manhattan, In the Spirit of Martin, The Living Legacy of Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., Through the Eyes of Others, African Americans and Identity in American Art, and Case Studies in Culture and Entrepreneurship, How to Create Relevant and Sustainable Institutions. As one of her former students, I know she enjoys teaching courses as African-American history and art and museum practice. Her favorite African-American artist is Elizabeth Catlett and Archibald Motley. She is one of the most powerful and brilliant women I ever met and one of my favorite persons in the United States. She is an innovative professor with a powerful voice everywhere she goes, and a great mentor. I am honored to meet her, Dr. Sorin, as a professor and a friend. And I am honored to introduce her in this presentation of her more recent book, Driving While Black. Welcome, Gretchen.
Thank you, Viri. That was so kind. I really appreciate it. I'm wondering if I can put up my slides now. Okay. Viri, that was very kind. I hope I live up to it.
Okay. All right, Gretchen, you're all set to share screen.
I'm right in the process of doing that. Okay. Well, good afternoon, everybody. And thanks for being here. Today, I'm going to talk about African-Americans, travel, the automobile, and something you may have heard about because of the Hollywood movie, The Negro Motorist Green Book. In order to get you in the mood, I would like to play a little bit of a piece of music called Christian Automobile, which really, I think this piece tells you how important the automobile was to African Americans. It compares the automobile to the Christian faith.
Oh, you know that every child
of God
running for Jesus
like an automobile.
And that's the Dixie Hummingbirds. So this afternoon, I'd like you all to think about mobility. Think about how important your mobility is to you, and think about the right to mobility and how important it is in a free society and in our American democracy, and the significant role that mobility has in facilitating a democracy. You have the ability, we have the ability to go where we want, when we want to go. Now, travel, the ability to travel is central to the African-American experience because the African-American experience begins with forced travel. So the ordeal of the Middle Passage and the enslavement of African-Americans begins the journey that becomes central to Black life and identity. And so forced travel shapes what it means to be a Black American. And of course, that means that when African-Americans have the travel, the ability to travel freely, that becomes incredibly important. Now, the mobility of African-Americans in the New World was restricted from the beginning. And this is what a slave pass might look like. They were often written on just small scraps of paper. This one says, please to let Benjamin McDaniel pass to Dr. Henkel's in Newmarket, Shenandoah County, Virginia, and return on Monday or Tuesday next to Montpelier for Mrs. Madison, June 1st, 1843. So this was the president, President Madison's wife, writing a pass for an enslaved African named Benjamin McDaniel. So travel for African Americans was strictly controlled and regulated. The freedom to travel then becomes an important aspect of freedom and later of middle-class identity. And freedom was so important that many enslaved persons ran away. They stole themselves and exercised their freedom of movement. Now, one thing I'd like you to consider is that the very first police forces in many communities were established as slave patrols. They guarded the communities at night to intimidate the enslaved population and to search for fugitive slaves and prevent them from running away. So this is really the foundation of our modern police departments. And here you can see the badges, the kinds of badges that were issued for plantation patrols, these early police departments. In the early 20th century, the Great Migration becomes the next stop in the journey to freedom. And this is the story of the greatest mass movement of people in the history of the United States. I love this photograph in particular because it's a photograph in my home state in New Jersey. Seeking opportunities in the North and fleeing racism and poverty in the South, as many as 7 million African Americans left the rural South to go to cities like Detroit and New York, Chicago, Philadelphia, and Newark, which is the city in New Jersey where my parents went. With these expanding opportunities in education and employment, you had more and more Black citizens moving into the ranks of the middle class. But in the first half of the 20th century, behavior for African Americans was prescribed by geography and by custom, and much of the country was segregated. Now in the South, it was segregated by the kinds of signs that you see here. But in the North, there was segregation as well, and that was really de facto segregation. There weren't signs, but by custom, African Americans knew where they could not go. Each state really had its own rules, and each community had an expected etiquette for African American behavior. Emmett Till didn't know the rules of racial etiquette, for example, and that was the reason he was murdered. But you could find that segregation existed in buses, taxis, trains, beaches, even in places like telephone booths and public toilets. And this is a Jim Crow car, rail car. These were filthy as well as dependent on timetables. And they were only supposed to run in the South, but they ran in the North as well. And sometimes it was just more convenient to keep African-Americans in these colored cars so that they wouldn't have to move when they got to Washington, D.C. So you can imagine this is why African-Americans loved their automobiles. The automobile freed Black travelers from the tyranny of the Jim Crow railroad car and the Jim Crow bus. And it offered the freedom of movement and dignity that they were looking for. But of course, riding in a car was not worry-free. Even though everything across the country was segregated, when you got into your car, you might have to worry about being overturned. You're having your car overturned by an angry mob. You might have to worry about violence. And you certainly found intimidation along the way. But by the 1950s, you do have an interstate highway system. And it's the interstate highway system that enables upwardly mobile Black families to become travel consumers. And they're consumers of refrigerators and television sets and coffee percolators, but they're also consumers of travel. And they purchase automobiles in large numbers. They buy campers and hotel rooms, and they buy restaurant meals. And these are all from Black-owned businesses, segregated businesses that are opened to serve this audience. Now, the make and model of your car was very important. And for African Americans, purchased cars for very specific and deliberate reasons. There was a series of market studies done for by African American newspapers in the 1940s and 1950s. And these firms surveyed all kinds of products, everything from flour and gasoline to automobiles. And one of the things that was found that was that African Americans liked larger cars. They liked large cars with large trunks. African Americans perceived of large cars as being more reliable. They preferred Buicks. They liked them to be heavy, hard to turn over. And they needed a trunk that was large enough to carry everything they needed. Now, if you were Black and you were driving and you were traveling across country or from north back to south to visit family, you might have to carry water for the radiator, extra fan belts, a cooler full of food, since you couldn't eat at restaurants. You might have to carry blankets and pillows. Since you couldn't stop at a hotel, you needed a big, large coffee can to pee in. You might have to carry other supplies as well. So with all of these things, even extra gas, sometimes they carried extra cans of gas because you couldn't necessarily be served at a gas station. So the make of your car was very important. And this is a picture of the Buick Electra. And the Buick Electra is, as you can tell, a huge car, very comfortable, wide seats. It looks like a sofa in the front and in the back. And the ad says, all the Electra lacks is a fireplace. So this is really a rolling living room. It was like your home away from home. And this is Chuck Berry, the famous Chuck Berry, with one of his Cadillacs. This is one of my favorite photographs. And we know that a lot of African Americans bought Cadillacs, but it was really only 3%. And that's exactly the same percentage of white Americans that bought Cadillacs. So that idea that Black people bought Cadillacs in a higher proportion than white people is just not true. And the people that bought the Cadillacs, very often they were famous performers, like Mahalia Jackson, she had a Cadillac, like Sammy Davis Jr., he had a Cadillac, and like Chuck Berry. And they always felt the need to justify their purchase of a Cadillac, even though they had the money to buy a Cadillac. And they felt that need because white Americans didn't feel that Black Americans should have nice cars, and particularly not nicer cars than they had, and which was a very kind of sad thing. Often if someone saw that a Black person had a nicer car than he, they might key the car or bump the car and knock out the light. So it was actually kind of a little bit dangerous to be seen in a Cadillac. Sometimes African Americans would carry a chauffeur's cap. And if they were stopped by the police, they would put the chauffeur's cap on and pretend that the car belonged to their employer. And that way, the police would not necessarily give them a ticket, because it was acceptable for African Americans to be a chauffeur when it wasn't acceptable for them to have a car. But very often, African Americans had these very expensive cars. And one of the reasons was that they couldn't buy a house. Black neighborhoods were redlined, and realtors and banks and the federal government colluded to prevent African Americans from being able to buy houses. And if you couldn't buy a house, you bought your next largest purchase was your automobile. So this is Medgar Evers, who was a civil rights worker in rural Mississippi. And the car that he chose was a Rocket 88. Now the Rocket was large enough to enable Medgar to stretch out for the night on the seats. And it responded immediately when he hit the gas pedal, enabling him to get away from a pursuing car. So if you can imagine, that's another reason for selecting your car. Can it get you away fast enough? This is a picture of the Rocket 88 that was the car that Medgar Evers owned. And this is a picture of the window that, with a bullet hole in it, of Medgar Evers' car window. He died beside his car in his driveway, shot by a sniper on June 12, 1963. So it was very dangerous to be a civil rights worker, even though he took every precaution. Now, the automobile was also a symbol of class status. And African Americans, and here, this is an absolutely stunning Cadillac on the street in Harlem. So think about the purchase of a car for African Americans. It posed a paradox. African Americans had the freedom to travel. They took the freedom to travel. But when they traveled, they were forced to stay in segregated Black neighborhoods and segregated Black tourist accommodations. They had to go to segregated beaches, to segregated resorts. And now I'd like you to think about what America was like before the automobile, before there were any automobiles. And what you had were people who stayed put. Everybody stayed put. They didn't travel very far from home. Most people stayed in their neighborhoods. Of course, there were some people that were able to travel abroad or that were able to travel to other places because there were trains and there were steamships. But most people didn't travel more than a few miles from home. And if you think about even traveling to upstate New York, when you see every town, a town every 8 to 10 miles, and every little town has its own Methodist church or its own Episcopal church or its own Presbyterian church, and they're only a few miles apart. That's because people stayed within their neighborhoods. White people generally lived in white neighborhoods. Black people lived in Black neighborhoods. And you didn't really find people crossing over into other neighborhoods. Now, in very poor neighborhoods, sometimes Black and white people lived side by side. But generally, the country, the entire nation, was segregated by race. And most of the country would be considered white spaces. But with their automobiles, African Americans crisscrossed the country, traveling through those white spaces. To get from one safe Black space to another safe Black space, they had to go through a variety of white spaces where they were unwelcome. So when my parents were traveling from Newark, New Jersey, back to my mother's home in Fayetteville, North Carolina, they were traveling through a lot of white spaces. And along the way, they faced signs and billboards and posters and objects that ranged from insulting to frightening, but they asserted their rights to unfettered travel by going where they wanted to go, when they wanted to go. And here are a couple of examples of the kinds of things that African Americans might face on the road. So the landscape itself was fraught with psychologically and emotionally damaging messages. And here is one in Alabama, which is basically the Klan welcomes you. Capital City Claverns welcomes you. This would be a scary sign for an African-American family. This is a popular restaurant chain on the West Coast, which started in Salt Lake City, but there was an entire chain of these restaurants throughout California. Called the Coon Chicken Inn, and nationally famous, it says, diners entered the restaurant through a giant coon's mouth. So you can imagine how you would feel if you saw this while you were traveling. And this is the banner across the main street in Greenville, Texas. It says, Greenville, welcome, the blackest land, the whitest people. And these words were also printed on the water tower that you could see for miles in the city. So this was also kind of frightening when African Americans were traveling. but generally there were a ton of sundown towns throughout the United States. And especially in the Midwest, there were hundreds and hundreds of sundown towns. Sheboygan, Wisconsin was a sundown town. Manitowoc was a sundown town. Darien, Connecticut was a sundown town. And there were literally hundreds of these places. These are entire communities that would allow African-Americans to be in the community during the day to work as cooks or as maids or gardeners. But then they needed to be out of town when the sun set. And Thurgood Marshall told an incredible story in his autobiography, which he says he was standing on a train platform and a man came up to him and said, "Nigger boy, what are you waiting for? What are you doing here?" And he says, "I'm waiting for the train to Shreveport." And the man says, "Well, you better be on it because the sun has never set with a nigger in this town." And so that was the kind of thing that African-Americans faced when they went traveling. So you had to be very careful. And of course, there was also intimidation. Some of them faced real violence, not just intimidation. And this is, you can imagine encountering this group of folks at a local fair. And this was the county fair in Colorado. So it was really all over the country. So in 1936, a man named Victor Green created the Negro Motorist Green Book in New York City. And this was a travel guide that provided lists of hotels and motels and restaurants and nightclubs and tourist homes, barbershops, beauty parlors, pharmacies, places where African Americans could get their car fixed, places of entertainment, places where you could stay overnight that were safe and that were clean. Victor Green believed that travel was fatal to prejudice. And that was his mantra. He put it on the Negro Motorist Green Book. It was a quote that he borrowed from Mark Twain. And it appears in The Innocents Abroad, Mark Twain's book, The Innocents Abroad. And he adopted it for the Negro Motorist Green Book. And here we have Victor and Alma Green. And I always show Alma because Victor Green started the Green Book, but Alma took it over. And Victor, in the late 1950s, Victor gets very sick. I don't know exactly what happens to him, but he gets sick and his wife Alma becomes the editor of the paper. He remains the face of the business, but it was very unusual at this time to have an all-woman, a woman-owned publishing company and an all-woman group working in the publishing company. And Alma and four women ran the Negro Motorist Green Book. And here you see a postcard, which is one of the ways that Green sold his travel guide. It was the most successful of the African-American travel guides. And believe me, there were many Black travel guides that were available to the Black community, not just the Green Book. The Green Book is just the most long-lasting. And it was the most long-lasting because Victor Green made a deal with Standard Oil. Standard Oil saw, which is at the time was Esso Gasoline, which is now called Exxon. But at the time, Standard Oil felt that the Black middle class was going to become a formidable market. And they decided they wanted to court that market. And in order to court that market, they made a partnership with Victor Green and they distributed the Negro Motorist Green Book nationwide. And that helped to keep his Green Book viable. And inside the Green Book, you would find advertisements like this for Esso gas stations, but there were also listings of YMCAs and churches, doctors, beauticians, and barbers. And there was at least one article in every issue of the Green Book. And the Green Book obviously courted the Black middle class, and it reflected Black middle class values, as you can see here. So polite, well-mannered behavior. Green, in addition to believing that travel was fatal to prejudice, he and his staff saw themselves as working to end discrimination in a very quiet, measured way. And you can see on the cover, his perfect Black couple with their matched luggage, their suburban home, and you see a little bit of their automobile. And the Green Book started out just in New York, New Jersey, Connecticut, and then it expanded to the entire East Coast, then to the Mississippi River, and then across the country. And finally, it included Europe, Africa, and Asia. Now, the Baltimore Afro-American also created their own travel map, and this is just an example of another travel guide that appeared in the 1942 issue of the newspaper. And there were other travel guides. One was called Travel Guide. There was the Go Guide, the Bronze American. And newspapers and magazines also included travel guides. And these are guides that were totally unknown to the white community, as were the businesses that served the Black community, the Black golf courses, the Black resorts, the Black swimming pools were all really unknown to the white community. This is an example of a YMCA dorm room. There were places that young men could stay. And here you see in the midst of with a college pennant and his middle-class furnishings. And this is Rock Rest. If you've ever been to the African American Museum in Washington, DC, this rock is now there. Rock Rest was a tourist home in Kittery, Maine that was run by Hazel and Clayton Sinclair. And the entirety of their collection was moved to the African American Museum in Washington. But here you can see, you get an idea of what the interior looked like, and Hazel serving a ladies' lunch. There were thriving African American businesses all over the United States that served the segregated audience. And here is the motel in McKenzie Court in Hot Springs, Arkansas. And segregation really created a demand for all of these African American tourist homes and guest houses and motor courts. This is a page from the Green Book, and it shows you the owners. I think the owners of these places wanted people to see that they were indeed African American. And it offered a whole variety of services, and courteous service was very important. You notice it says courteous service and Southern hospitality, and then at the bottom, 5-point service station, courteous service, because that's what African Americans were looking for. They were looking for courteous service, to be treated kindly and not with disdain. I always take issue with the national parks comment. I guess it's the Ken Burns film that says America's best idea, because the national parks were indeed segregated. The parks themselves were integrated. Anybody could go in the park. Anyone was welcome in the park. But all of the national parks had, all of the concessions were private owners, and all of the concessions were segregated. So you could get to the park, you could go to Yellowstone, you could go to Grand Teton, you could go to any of the national parks. This is a photograph from Shenandoah National Park. And the parking areas, the bathrooms, and all of the attendant services were segregated. So you'd get to the park and you wouldn't have a place to stay, or you would have the most primitive, filthy accommodations because they were segregated. Keep in mind, the automobile becomes an incredibly important tool for civil rights. And this is Ware's Market in Memphis. And you see that Ware is tying himself to Martin Luther King and Ralph Abernathy, which was an extremely dangerous thing to do. But these men, the people that advertised in the Green Book, were using travel as a method of quiet activism, and they were using their advertisements as a method of quiet activism. And here you see Al Hibbler at the beginning, on the left-hand side, who is in a march. If you think about civil rights, you think about marches and demonstrations. Where did these people eat when they were in the South? Where did they stay? Well, they stayed at the same accommodations, the tourist homes, the guest houses, the hotels that were in the African American community. And all of these business owners were taking their businesses and their lives in their hands when they allowed civil rights workers to stay there. And this is an example. This is the L.G. Gaston Motel in Birmingham just after it was bombed. And it was bombed because Gaston was allowing civil rights workers to meet there and civil rights workers to stay there during their marches. This is the Jenkins microbus. Now, if you were traveling around a county or a state, registering voters, bringing health services to people, bringing education to people, helping them pass the poll tax, you would need a vehicle. You had to have an automobile. This one is now at the Smithsonian. It was used in South Carolina to travel around the county in South Carolina to register voters. And you had to have a car for that. Similarly, middle-class Americans used their cars here in bus boycotts. And this particular one, Martin Luther King is on the right, is the Montgomery bus boycott. And in order for people to maintain their jobs, they needed to get to work. And in order to get to work, they had to have automobiles. So in the Montgomery bus boycott, they purchased a fleet of station wagons and other cars, and they used those cars to drive people to work. They were able to reduce ridership on the buses by 69%. And the following year, the bus company actually went out of business because of the boycott. So the question I have for you today is, how does the story end? In 1964, Lyndon Johnson passes major civil rights legislation that extends voting rights and outlaws segregation. And the NAACP and other civil rights organizations had been protesting, and they forced open the major hotel chains like Howard Johnson's and Hilton. And when they opened them to African-Americans, African-Americans went to the major chains because they could. As a result, the African-American businesses started to close because now there wasn't enough support for the African-American businesses to maintain those hotels and restaurants. But the question is, does the story end, or does it remain an issue in America? This is Philando Castile, who was murdered in his automobile by a Minnesota police officer in 2016 in Falcon Heights, Minnesota. And the officer was acquitted of manslaughter. And of course, this is Kadir Nelson's cover on the New Yorker for the week of June 22nd this year. And it's a staggering cover because it has the faces of so many African Americans who have been murdered, many of them by police officers. So going out on the road is still something that can be extremely dangerous for African Americans. This is Stuart Carlson's cartoon. It's from the Milwaukee Journal Sentinel, and it's handy hints for drivers stopped by the police. Be courteous, obey all lawful orders, have license and registration ready, avoid being Black. The end.
Thank you, Gretchen, so much for...
Just add one thing. So the Green Book goes out of business, and the Black hotels and the motels gradually lose their clientele, and the large chains take over. But you can really say that the landscape for African Americans was entirely changed by the automobile and by travel. So thank you.
Thank you, Gretchen. For anybody who doesn't know, I'm Olivia Cipriano. I'm the manager of programs and operations. Normally I begin programs, but today Viri, who was once a student of Gretchen, introduced her, and we love Viri, and she's often in a lot of our programs. But I wanted to kind of ask the audience if there are any questions either on Facebook or if you're on Zoom, you can put them in the chat box. I can facilitate those to Gretchen. I thought this was such a wonderful program. I thought it was so informative, and it's something that we really need to think about in terms of perspective of because at this point, you know, so much time has passed since the automobile, but it still has its effects on our society. I mean, you know, at the end, you were talking about how a lot of Black-owned businesses were out of business that were once in the Green Book. And I think there's a really big movement nowadays about supporting Black-owned businesses and kind of returning to that. And I kind of wanted to know some of your thoughts on that.
Well, I've been asking people if they would please, if they're going to buy the book, to please buy it from a Black-owned business. I know that the Black-owned independent bookstores are having a resurgence of interest in the last couple of months, which is really wonderful, I think. You know, it's interesting. I guess the editor of Ebony said it wasn't that African Americans stopped using Black-owned businesses, it was that white Americans didn't adopt any Black-owned businesses, didn't support them at all. And that was the reason they went out of business, because the NAACP and the other civil rights organizations worked so hard to break open the Sheraton Hotel, to break open Howard Johnson's and Hilton. So yes, people went to them because they said, you know, we have the opportunity to go to the Hilton, we're gonna go. Okay, so you had some people that are leaving and going to those large chain hotels. Other Black people stuck with the Black businesses, but there weren't any white people that decided, okay, we're gonna go to these Black businesses and patronize them. And that's the reason that they went out of business. They just didn't have, the margin was so small. They just didn't have enough support to keep them keep them going.
Yeah, I think it's a very interesting way of thinking about how we all need to do our part in making sure that we're supporting everyone. You know, it's important for everyone to realize that they all play a part in supporting this. And I love that.
And I see that somebody said that Bronxville was a sundown town. I thought yeah. That was really interesting.
It's
not surprising, but it's...
Gretchen, I have a question for you. So going back to your book, I read in an interview that you have with somebody else in a newspaper in, I think, Upstate, that you mentioned that part of the research also, you are telling your personal story. Could you talk more about that? I know in one part of your book, you mentioned that your family had some practices when you were traveling to North Carolina. Could you mention something?
Well, I when I was researching the book, I was really researching it. It started out as my dissertation, and it didn't dawn on me until I was well into the research that I was really telling my own story, that I was telling my family's story. And it helped me to understand my parents. And I think that was one of the most wonderful things that came out of this book, because we used to get up in the morning. We would go to Fayetteville, North Carolina every summer. My parents moved to Newark, New Jersey in the late 1940s, before I was born. And they were part of the Great Migration, the second wave of the Great Migration. And as a result, every summer of my life, when I was a kid, my brother and I, we were hauled back to Fayetteville, North Carolina, to spend summer with cousins and family members, and so that my mother could visit her family. And when we would travel, we never stopped anywhere. I mean, we went from Newark, New Jersey to Fayetteville, North Carolina, straight through, no stopping. My father would gas up the car in New Jersey, and we had food in the car. We had this huge, heavy iron, metal Coleman cooler, and my mother would fill it with chicken and potato salad and all kinds of food, and we never stopped unless there was gas, unless we needed gas. It's the only thing we stopped for, or to eat by the side of the road, but never to go into any kind of restaurant or stay overnight. And we drove mostly at night, which I thought was crazy. You know, we'd get up at 3 a.m. and drive while it was still dark. And I always thought that was kind of crazy. Why do we do that? And I interviewed other people. I interviewed Lonnie Bunch, the Secretary of the Smithsonian. I interviewed other African-Americans who are my age. And I found out that they all did the same thing. They drove at night. At night, if you're driving at night, it's harder for the police to tell if there's somebody Black driving, right? They're not gonna stop just any car if they're looking for blacks to pull over. So that's one reason for driving at night. It also meant, by the way, and not, it didn't happen to us, but a lot of African-Americans were involved in traffic accidents because they were sleepy, especially entertainers. There were a lot of entertainers and musicians that were involved in traffic accidents because they had just performed and then they had to get in the car and drive to another town. But I digress. But my story, it really dawned on me halfway through that I was really explaining my parents' behavior and explaining who they were. And so it was really a kind of self-discovery for me doing the research.
Thank you. We have another question about, just going back to the first question, did any of the hotel chains buy the Black-owned hotels? Do you know about?
That's a good question. I would say that the major Black-owned hotels, like the Hotel Teresa in New York City, the Hampton House in Miami, no. Not that I know of. They continued to be Black-owned hotels until they went out of business.
Thank you for answering that, and thank you for asking, Sandy. On Facebook, we had a question. Is Medgar Evers' car in a museum?
Good question. I don't know. I do know that the Cadillac that Chuck Berry has is at the African American Museum, and that the Jenkins microbus that was used for registering voters is at the Smithsonian also. But I do not know if Medgar Evers' car is in a museum. That is a great question. I will have to check that out.
Yeah. We have a question from Sarah Linda. She was saying, thank you so much for sharing your insights. And would you be able to elaborate on the plantation patrols and how they morphed into the modern system of policing and how they may have been related to the suppression of immigrant communities and labor in the North?
So when the police departments are formed as these slave catchers with their badges, they are totally legal, right? Because the fugitive slave law requires in 1850 requires that people be put back into slavery. It requires that, you know, slave catchers are totally legal. What happens after emancipation is that the quote unquote slave catchers become vigilantes. And I was thinking about this morning, watching the coverage of John Lewis's death, because the people that are beating those demonstrators, those lawful, peaceful demonstrators, as they go over the bridge, the Pettus Bridge, are police officers. They're having their heads beaten in with nightsticks by police officers. So you have police who become vigilantes particularly in the South, and those police are violent vigilantes who are illegally following what was legal under the slave catchers. And that continues, yes, in the North. There seems to be a problem that we have with lawful, peaceful demonstrators. Even though it's constitutional, we don't like it when Black people protest. We don't like it when poor people protest. And so the government has had a tendency, and the police have had a tendency to step in. We are the ones that give the police these powers. We have given them the power to do unlawful things and to become judge, jury, and executioners. I don't, you know, since when does selling loose cigarettes become a death penalty offense? Since when does passing a counterfeit $20 bill or whatever it was, become a death penalty offense? I was thinking about this because I, living in a resort town, living near Cooperstown, I have passed a counterfeit $100 bill by accident. I had no idea. It was given to me by a bank. I passed it to another bank, and that bank recognized it as a counterfeit. Now, they they're required, when a counterfeit bill turns up, to call the FBI. They're not required to call the local police and have the police come and arrest you. Because most people that pass counterfeit bills don't know it, because you don't recognize the bill as counterfeit. So this whole George Floyd thing to me seemed so senseless and so ridiculous, because a counterfeit bill, if you've ever seen one, and I saw this 100 and I could not tell it from a real bill, and I passed it because I thought it was a regular bill. I'm sure he did as well. You know, it's not a criminal, it's not a criminal offense. Most counterfeit money is just passed, you know, 20s, 30s, 20s, 50s, 100s. They're just passed because it doesn't make sense for somebody to give you, you know, $5,000 worth of counterfeit money. It's going to be identified as counterfeit. It makes sense to put that money in with real money and just pass it very easily and slowly through the, you know, through the money transfers process. And I'm sure everybody has passed a counterfeit bill that hasn't been detected at some point or another. So it just seems so ridiculous to me.
Yeah. It's a big one, you know. It's something that happens far too often where police are called in unnecessary situations. But moving,
well, it speaks to the systemic nature of racism in this country.
Yeah,
you know, that there's this terrible fear of Black men and their you know, unfounded.
For sure. We have a couple of questions in the group chat. Give me one moment to scroll back up. Mary was asking, or she was telling you how much she relates to your story. She's from New Jersey too, with relatives on both sides, North Carolina, I think Virginia, and they always get up at 4 a.m. to beat traffic. But she was wondering if you could talk more about national parks, and she's kind of always understood it as the passage of the Homestead Act extended segregation to places that ultimately became national parks. And Masha was also interested in knowing more about the national parks.
Well, so what's really interesting is that the national parks have been recently doing a study, and they found that very few African Americans actually go to the national parks. And I think there are a couple of reasons for this. One is that African Americans are afraid to go in the woods, because you might encounter crazy white people with guns. You don't know who you're going to encounter when you go into the woods. That's one reason for not going to the parks. But the other is that the parks themselves were open and available. You could, you know, you didn't have to, it didn't matter if you were Black or white. The admission to the park was open to everyone. But the all the accommodations, whether it was cabins, hotels, restaurants, the shops for buying souvenirs, all of those things were segregated. They were all separately segregated. So you might possibly find one that wasn't segregated, but then you really didn't know. So if you're driving all the way from New Jersey or Delaware or New York, all the way out west to a national park, you really had a problem trying to find a place to stay. One of the things that was really terrific about Rock Rest was that the owner of Rock Rest kept a diary when they traveled. And they traveled out to the national parks. And she writes about the places that they stayed. And some of them said, no Mexicans. And others of them said, no Indians. And some of them said, no Negroes. Can you imagine, you're traveling in the country and it's like, gee, where can we stay? Where can we stay the night? Well, we can't stay here because there are no Mexicans here, and you can't stay here because there's no Indians here, and you can't stay, you know, these places decided, and they put up a sign that said, these are the kinds of people that we don't want. And you had to worry about that. You know, you had to worry about how you looked or how you sounded or, you know, what your background was and whether or not you could pass. So, you know, I think the reason that the national parks are still places that African Americans don't want to go. I think there are a lot of reasons that include the past history of segregation, as well as, you know, who are you going to encounter if you go into one of the parks and go into the backwoods?
Yeah, it's that feeling of not being welcome is still extended in a lot of those areas, and a lot of institutions, I feel as well. You know, even walking into a store that, you know, they might not be allowed to openly say no Mexicans or no Blacks, you know, you still get that feeling when you go check out or when you even walk in and you're being watched.
And I've been followed in museums by guards, you know, where the guard just, you go into the museum and the guard just is riveted on you and just follows you around. And, you know, you really start to watch the guard more than you watch, look at the art or the, you know, the exhibitions, because you're watching that guard follow you and you're thinking, why is this guard following me? Oh, I know why. And then this is not a welcoming, this is not a welcoming situation, you know, when there's a guard obviously following you and not following other people.
Yeah. Mary also wanted to expand on what you had said, and that this is an aspect of whiteness of the environmental movement that a lot of people don't understand. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. It's that feeling of exclusion I feel a lot of the times, where, you know, you don't feel comfortable talking about it because, like, you can't really do a lot of the things because you don't feel comfortable going those places.
I spoke to a group called the Case Against Cars, and they're a group that would like to ban all automobiles. And she asked me, she said, "You mean Black people really like cars?" And I said, "You bet we do." And she said, well, you know, it never dawned on her. She's an environmentalist and she would like everybody to ride a bicycle or take public transportation. And I said, if African-Americans took public transportation in the period before the 1960s, it would all be segregated. And that just hadn't dawned on her that all of public transportation was segregated before the 1960s. You know, she thought cars were bad. And interestingly, there's a lot of literature about automobiles, warning against the automobile, saying we shouldn't have cars. This is in the 1930s and 40s. Cars, they call them the devil wagon, and in the 20s as well, the devil wagons. We don't want these devil wagons. They're going to destroy families and destroy communities, and they're going to pollute the environment, and they're going to be cause accidents. African Americans never say that or think that. African-Americans are like, yeah, cars, yes, we want them. Those are, bring them on. That gives us independence. It gives us freedom. It gets us off of these segregated conveyances. So it's a totally different attitude toward the automobile than for white Americans.
Yeah. Let's see, let me check. On Facebook, we have a question from Eugenia, who was wondering, she wanted to thank you, and she thought it was so informative and fascinating, but is there some place that we can find lists of Black businesses? I think that's more within your community type thing, right? You gotta kind of do a little bit of research.
There are those within your community, but there's a list of independent Black bookstores online. If you just Google independent Black bookstores, they will come up. And there are some in New York, and they're all over the country. They're in New Jersey, they're in California, they're all over the United States. There are Black bookstores, Chicago, primarily urban areas, but there are lots of them.
Yeah.
Gretchen, I want to just have a tough question, and I don't expect that you respond this question. And I feel that this is a hot topic, and this is a subject about segregation that we should talk. But my question is regarding how in United States we can work on inclusion and diversity. What do you think we should work together in these institutions? I know you're an expert in museums, but I think we can just talk about not just the historic facts that we have about segregation in the whole country. Just let's think about what we can do. And I am asking you, thinking that you're a museum professional, what are your recommendations?
I think museums need to get their houses in order first and address their lack of diversity on their boards. I think it's got to start for museums. They've got to start with their greater board diversity, which is, you know, last week, the Chronicle of Philanthropy did a really interesting webinar that I couldn't get into. It was already full, but it was on how to cultivate Black donors and the and minority donors, you know, donors of color. And when the Smithsonian decided they were going to build the National Museum of African American History and Culture, all the leaders at the Smithsonian, the top people at the Smithsonian, told Lonnie Bunch that there was no chance they could raise enough money to build that museum because Black people didn't have any money. And they were shocked at the amount of money that they raised for that museum, as well as the amazing artifacts that came out of the woodwork for that museum. And what it really showed was how lacking in understanding the Smithsonian was about the Black community and who's in it and how much money Black people actually have. So I think there's a lot of misunderstanding there, but I think Black donors are not going to give to museums unless, and donors of color are not going to give to museums unless museums have something that Black people want to see. And if they don't feel welcome, and if they don't feel that there's something there representing their community, they're not going to go to those museums, and they're not going to get that money. And it's certainly an untapped audience, but it's also an untapped amount of, there are untapped donors there and untapped board members. But I do think generally we have to work with police departments. Police departments in this country need a lot of work. You know, I listen to my husband thinks you got to just hire different people. They're hiring the wrong people. You know, they need psychological testing. But if you think about it, police in this country, they go to the firing range, the shooting range every month. They're required to shoot and practice their shooting and practice their shooting and practice their shooting. They're never required to practice their interpersonal skills. They're diffusing a situation skills. They're identifying people who are mentally ill skills. They don't practice any of those human skills. They only practice shooting. And you can tell that that's what they, you know, that that's the first thing, you know, shoot. And I think we need to have a different mindset. And talking to the police chief in Montreal, and Vera, you met him. You may not remember, but you met him on our field trip. The police chief in Montreal.
Oh, yeah, I remember him.
Yes, and in interviewing him, he said that he tells people the police should be problem solvers, not law enforcers only. And we think our police are law enforcers. They're going to enforce every law. Oh, your light is out in the back of your car? We're going to give you a ticket. They're going to enforce the law. But he said, we need problem solvers. And a problem solver means that, he was telling me, they have a huge problem with Hasidic Jews. Hasidic Jews who are going to, on Friday, they have to be home by Shabbos. You know, they have to be home by sundown. And if sundown comes and they're in a big traffic jam, they will just get out of their car and leave it in the middle of the street. Just get out of it and walk home. So one way to handle that, to enforce the law, you get that car, you tow it, you put it in the impound lot, you go to the guy, you give him a ticket, you put him in the system. He has to go to court. He has to go to the impound lot to get his car out, pay a fine. That is law enforcement. He says a problem solver will get in that car, pull it over to the side of the road, and just leave it there parked. Problem solved. The person has not gone into the system. You haven't spent all this money on the courts and all of the money it costs to go into the system. It's thinking about people and your community and how you serve them in a different way. It's problem solving as opposed to only law enforcement. There are bad people out there. There are criminals out there. Yes, they need to go to jail, but not everybody. We don't, our police think of everybody as a criminal. Everybody's breaking the law. Think about some people have religious issues, right? The Hasidic Jews, they have a religious issue. Other people might be mentally ill. Other people might be homeless. Other people might just be lost or, you know, ill. Solve a problem. Don't think of everything as a law enforcement issue. Everybody doesn't need to go to jail. Everybody doesn't need to be arrested. You know, that's my thinking, that we really need to work on our police and our and their mindset, how they think about the public. Long answer for a very hard question.
Thank you. I love the idea of thinking about hiring problem solvers than law enforcers. That's a great way to phrase it and think about it and kind of relay that message to people who may not understand what.
It's protect and serve. Where's the serve part?
Exactly. so I think we're approaching our hour, unfortunately, but I wanted to say thank you. Is there any last words you want to leave us with, Gretchen?
I hope that everyone is going to, a democracy only works if we make it work. And I think it's really important and incumbent on all of us to make the democracy work and to be engaged and to be involved. So I hope people will continue to do that. It's been kind of important during this COVID-19, you know, people have become really active and really, you know, letting our elected officials know how we feel. And I hope people will continue to do that.
Yes, thank you. So thank you, Gretchen. And your book, Driving While Black, I will have the link posted both in the Facebook chat and in the Zoom chat right here. I'm pasting it right now. I also want to thank the audience for coming here today. Your continued support and attendance to these programs really keeps us going and alive. And we really want to continue these virtual programs through when we open, even on July 25th. We want to continue doing all of this. I also want to give a big thank you to Art Bridges. They are the funders of our exhibit Self in the City, and they work with us, they loan out art, and their message is really about accessibility to different communities across and spreading American art through kind of across the country in smaller museums and large museums. And we really wouldn't be able to have programs like this without their support. Talking about programs, we have some programs coming up this week. We have our virtual planetarium show for kids on Tuesday at 11:30. We have our art project live, The Past Worlds and Future People, on Wednesday at 11:30. And Thursday, we have two really fun workshops. One really fun workshop and one fun program. At 5, we have a hip hop workshop, which I would encourage you all to come to. It's called From Sidewalk to Stage with Dynamic Rockers. And at 7, right after, we have The Sky Tonight, which is our live planetarium shows geared more towards adults. And I cannot forget, on Sunday, our curator's tour from home with Laura Vukels is about Derrick Adams Selects, our exhibit at the museum right now. So as I mentioned earlier, we are reopening this week, actually, on the 25th of July. And we really hope that you guys can come and check out all these exhibits that we've been talking about for months on here. You guys can register for a time slot on www.hrm.org. And you guys can pick a time slot, sign up and come for that time slot. We are trying to do everything to make this reopening as safe for our staff and for all of our visitors coming in. Again, I wanna thank you, Gretchen, so much for joining us. This program was amazing. It's very important.
Thank you.
No problem. It was a pleasure to have you. And I wanna thank the audience again for coming here. Have a great day, everybody.
Bye-bye.
Bye.
Bye-bye. Thank you, Gretchen.